50% from previous years. Thank you so much for coming and this demonstration. It's absolutely fantastic. And we are live streaming this segment right now on ABA.com and on our Facebook page, which extends our reach even further. That's awesome. And it's important, frankly, because this year poses the biggest opportunity that we have had in a long time to see some action on much-needed regulatory relief. And that's because we have a new administration that has pledged to relieve banks and businesses in general, frankly, of counterproductive over-regulation. And we have a Congress where both Democrats and Republicans, having heard from their banker constituents over the past few years, have come to understand that some parts of Dodd-Frank have overshot the mark and need adjusting. So to make the most of this opportunity, we needed a big showing here today, and you absolutely delivered. Thank you again. I'd like to especially thank our Government Relations Council members who are here today. These men and women are the backbone of our policy advocacy operation. They dissect the issues, they share their perspectives, help us identify priorities, and ultimately led the process to produce our blueprint for growth, which is guiding our policy positions. This blueprint is a good example of ABA's approach to advocacy. Advocacy that is positive, proactive, and collaborative. The blueprint is positive because it articulates what banks are for. We are for policies that create jobs in our communities and grow the nation's economy. We are for policies that will help our customers succeed financially. That is the essential message we sent in a letter to President Trump when he was first elected. And it's the message 9 community bankers from ABA and ICBA delivered in person earlier this month in a meeting with the president in the White House. You'll hear more about that meeting tomorrow from a number of the bankers who were part of it. It makes sense that you, as bankers, would be for pro-growth policies. You are community and economic developers. You know what towns and cities need to thrive. And it's your duty and privilege to share that knowledge with policymakers. Our blueprint is proactive because it seeks to put solutions to broader problems on the table so that we can be a resource to policymakers. For example, our blueprint calls for solutions to the growing problem of student debt. There are more than 44 million Americans with student loans totaling more than $1.3 trillion. That's more than auto loans or credit card debt, and it's a huge burden on our latest generation. And in fact, there are some estimates that show that that number will double, that debt burden will double over the next 10 years. Today, approximately 7 out of 10 graduates enter their first jobs with an average of $35,000 of student debt. Their burden of student debt is the largest of any generation. And that's impeding their ability to save for a big purchase, to start a business, or invest in their retirement. As an aside, this is why ABA introduced a new student debt repayment benefit for our workforce here in Washington. And it's why we recently endorsed a company that can help banks all across the country do the same for their employees, with the goal so that they can recruit and retain millennials, the bankers of tomorrow. Our blueprint shows that banks want to be part of the solution to this and other problems affecting our customers. Our blueprint also urges policies that can help fuel small business growth, protect customers from data breaches, and help rural America thrive. These are all in addition to the policy changes banks need to better serve their clients, customers, and communities. And let me be clear, we are not anti-regulation. We are for smarter, more tailored regulation, as well as capital reform and more sensible mortgage rules. Our pursuit of the blueprint is collaborative. I mentioned earlier that ABA and ICBA were at the White House together. We know the importance of unity and the fact that we will be stronger by working together. Our nation's capital markets, as many of you heard me say, are the envy of the globe, precisely because we have community banks, mid-sized banks, regional banks, and large globally active banks that serve the needs of America's households, farmers, small businesses, and governments. It's critically important that we fight to preserve this diversity of banks so that together we continue to help America's communities thrive. It's important to be unified both within our industry, but also with those outside it that share a common interest. That's why we are taking every chance to work with others like ISCBA as we pursue, for example, a level playing field with credit unions and farm credit. We will continue to build alliances with anyone, such as NFIB, the U.S. Chamber, home builders, realtors, whenever and wherever our goals are aligned. We are already doing this on tax reform, just as we built coalitions in the past to improve mortgage lending rules. And speaking of tax reform, we think efforts to make our tax code more globally competitive is a smart way to spur economic growth and create jobs and prosperity here in America. So we're very deeply engaged in those discussions for that reason, but also to make sure that banks are not used as a pay-for in any tax reform bill. That happened to us once already, quite recently, with the 2015 highway spending bill. That bill took $17 billion from 72 banks to pay for our nation's roads and bridges. That's more than just offensive public policy, in my opinion. We think it's illegal. And that's why we filed suit last month challenging the FAST Act. We're hoping to see some resolution on this case this summer. Your very presence here today is also very positive. It's proactive and collaborative. We've got representatives from banks of all sizes and business models here to advocate solutions that will help you better serve your customers, clients, and communities. And you're reaching out to members of both parties to develop a consensus around these important solutions. The last panel of Stan and James prepared you for your visits to Capitol Hill. I thought I would take a moment to get Capitol Hill ready for you. So we're going to do that together. This is going to be interactive by sending an email with just a couple of clicks on your phone to your elected lawmaker telling them why we need regulatory relief. So to do that, I'm asking all of you, and I know this is unusual for a speaker, but I'm asking all of you please to take out your phones. So everyone take out your phones and then get ready to send a text message. So where you would normally enter a contact name or recipient, I want you to type this number. So prepare to send a message and type this number, 40649. And then in the body of the message, type the word banker. I know you can all spell banker. So just to repeat, send a text, I'll do it myself, to 40649 with the word banker. You should all be getting a message back with a link. Click on the link and fill in your information. This will send your lawmaker an email letting them know why we need comprehensive, sensible, bipartisan regulatory relief legislation. If you're having any trouble, raise your hand and an ABA staff member will come and help you. We have several people roaming the room to help. Okay, I see people typing on their phones. That's great. All of you watching online can do this. In fact, please do. Once you're done sending that email, raise your phone so your neighbors know that you have taken action. Starting to see some phones being raised. That's great. In fact, turn the face of the phone to me, because then way I can see the, oh, that's fantastic. There we go. As you send your messages, we're going to see pin drops on the maps to the left and the right, showing all the emails being sent and all of the members of Congress receiving those emails. We're going to go back to the screen, but as someone from the Pacific Northwest, I want to see some more pins dropping up there in Idaho and in Oregon and Washington. And the West Coast, we got a lot of people in California. We need to see some more pins dropping there, too. That is fantastic. There are nearly 1,500 people in this room and still more watching this through our live stream on ABA.com and on Facebook Live. So we should see hundreds of pins dropping on the map. Let's cover the map, please. While you're doing this, I'd like to say, if we'll come back to the map, but I'd like to say a few words about ABA and bankers working together to increase our industry's political engagement. For the past year, we've been encouraging bankers everywhere to power up, and that's part of our effort to enhance our industry's political capabilities. It's a very proactive approach to advocacy. Let's be clear, your business is influenced too much by Washington for you not to be engaged in the political process. Engagement comes in a few forms. Just today, you are all sending grassroots emails, and later today, you'll be meeting with your lawmakers. That's kind of classic grassroots engagement. Bankers can also engage by joining BankPAC and by giving to the Fund for Economic Growth, our 501c4. And in fact, we need bankers to do all three of these things in order to build our industry's political capacity. And that's why we're calling all of you who have done this power players. All three of these things. We've got more than 200 power players here today. Thank you very much. And I want to give a special thanks to Howard Jaffe, who's the chair of our Community Bankers Council, for recruiting so many of them. Howard's been like a dog with a bone getting the council members to sign on to the cause. Howard, I'd like to clone you. We've added yet another element to our Power Up program. The ultimate in political engagement goes beyond building relationships with your lawmaker to actually becoming one. That's why earlier this week, ABA recently announced a pilot candidate school. It'll be held in September for a limited number of students. We'll teach you everything you need to know about running for state or federal office, such as how to file the needed paperwork, managing paid and earned media, fundraising, research, voter targeting, get out the vote, everything. If you or someone you know has considered running for office and are serious about taking the next step, please apply for this program. You can find an application and information at aba.com/runforoffice. We've just opened our applications last week and we'll be accepting them through June 1st. So if you think you are ready for this next step or know a banker or a bank director ready for this next step, I encourage you to check this out. Just 18 of the 535 members of the current Congress have a banking background, and only 5 members of the House Financial Services Committee do. That just doesn't make sense, because when it's time to set banking and economic policy, nothing beats real-world banking experience. And if we want to have a better public policy conversation around banks, we need more bankers in office, full stop. And the ABA will help recruit them and train them and send them on their way. All right, let's go back to the live action alert and let's see where we are ending up with our pin drops. I see a lot more pins. This is great. But you know, I know there's some big delegations out there. I know Virginia's got a lot of people here. I know Pennsylvania has a lot of people here. I know Texas has a lot of people here. I know Michigan has a lot of people here, among a number of other states. So I want to see more pins. I still need more pins in the Pacific Northwest. But this is great. It's really impressive. This is fantastic. So keep it coming. Now, continuing on advocacy, there are several bankers in this room who excel at this. It's been catching on ever since Max Cook, president and CEO of the Missouri Bankers Association, helped stand up ABA's Banker and Advocacy Grassroots Committee a few years ago. As the founding co-chair of that committee, Max has been instrumental in our efforts to power up the industry's advocacy, encouraging both bankers and state associations as well to do more. He's a leader in supporting BankPAC and in the Fund for Economic Growth, and has always been outspoken about the fact that advocacy successes require industry unity. Max is highly respected and well-known by lawmakers in the Show Me State. Recently, he hosted Representative Blaine Lutkenmeyer and Federal Reserve Bank President Esther George, and was able to show them the many ways that banks help communities thrive throughout Missouri. And he explained to them why more pro-growth policies are desperately needed right now. Let's thank Max Cook, my good friend, for his leadership. Another form of positive advocacy is our America's Banks reputational campaign. It's critically important, in our view, that ABA, as your trade association, tell banking's story publicly to lawmakers and others. That's why we launched the campaign last summer, and we are now looking to expand it. It's a digital campaign that promotes the good and important work banks do in and for their communities. It involves ads, digital ads primarily, and social media posts, all of which link back to our campaign's homepage, aba.com/americasbanks. By all measurements, it has been a success, and we want to build on that. So we're asking you all today to jump in. We've got a new social media guide to tell you exactly how you can participate. We'll also have a panel on this tomorrow, which will be fascinating. The short answer is you use our hashtag, America's Banks, in your social media posts. The longer answer can be found in the guide at the address that you will see in just a moment on the screen. And to tie it all together, we have America's Banks button for you to wear as you head to Capitol Hill later today. With nearly 1,500 of you heading up there this afternoon, it's important that people on the Hill see you as part of a cohesive movement. These buttons will tell them you are part of an important industry that is delivering jobs, growth, safety, and convenience. We'll be passing out those buttons as you leave the room here today. Let me conclude by thanking you again for being here, for walking the talk. We have a lot of opportunity ahead. Lots of opportunity this year, lots of opportunity. Not just because we have a new Congress and obviously a new administration, but because you have been building the case for things like bipartisan common sense regulatory relief for years with Democrats and with Republicans, lawmakers and regulators. And there is a growing recognition up and down Pennsylvania Avenue that something needs to be done. The key to turning this opportunity into action is you. And based on what I'm seeing on the screens, I am highly, highly encouraged. When you talk today to your elected representatives about the specific policies that have impact on your customers, their constituents back home, you're exercising a critically important civic right and responsibility. So thank you for speaking up. And in fact, regarding your Hill visits this afternoon, let me be clear. Stress the need for real, vivid stories that capture the impact of policies on your customers, clients, and communities. Ultimately, our message is simple. Give America's banks room to grow, and they'll drive the economy forward. Thank you very much for being here at our summit. The numbers are off the chart. The zeal and enthusiasm that you have all demonstrated is so, so important. The opportunities and possibilities that we have this year are so, so important. What banks do in our nation to help our economy grow and prosper and create jobs are so, so important. So thank you so much for being here. Thank you for listening. Thank you for the time you'll spend on the Hill today. And we're going to have you, as I exit the stage, watch a video, a Take Your Lawmaker to Work video, which is a textbook illustration of how to build proactive working relationships with your members of Congress. Thank you very much again for being here. I'm so excited about this year. Thank you.